Good morning, and welcome to Bethel Bible Church Online. We know things are a little bit different, but we are trying to be as faithful as we can to serve you guys and anyone who might happen to watch this as well. We want to say welcome to you, and we hope that you are also encouraged by the gathering of believers this morning in as many ways as we can during this time of quarantining. I'd like to open up with a word from the Lord in Psalm chapter 44, verses 4 through 8. You are my king, O God. Ordain salvation for Jacob. Through you we push down our foes. Through your name we tread down those who rise up against us. For not in my bow do I trust, nor can my sword save me. But you have saved us from our foes, and have put to shame those who hate us. In God we have boasted continually, and we will give thanks to your name forever. I just want to say that as we start the service this morning, we want to have our focus there, that we can boast continually in God's work and God's faithfulness. As a matter of fact, when Jesus died on the cross and rose again for us, he did it in such perfect timing that he knew that today would be a day that we depend on our belief in that for hope and for certainty, in a time where not a lot of people have that certainty. So we want to invite you this morning to get ready to worship, to turn off all of the distractions that you might have going on in your world right now, and look to Him. Find hope in Him. We want you to join along with us in the singing. We want you to tune in as Pastor Steve shares from God's Word, because we honestly believe as a church that we can get through this time together and still remain faithful. As a matter of fact, I have faithful hope and confidence that the believers in Jesus Christ will come out of this conflict believing more and having more faith than when we entered into it. So as we transition into our next part of the service, keep that in mind, that God still has things to say, and God still demands obedience from those who are carrying his banner through this time. So we want you to join us in joy, in faithful expectation, while bringing all of the baggage that you have to Jesus, because he's ready to carry our burdens. He's ready to carry our doubts and our uncertainties. So we want to take this time this morning to give that to him through worship, through singing, and through listening to the Word of God. So stay tuned as we move into our next transition. Thank you.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He's risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing. Shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won, and He's risen from the dead, and for my God, fall on close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. Will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place, to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way, bring me back to you.
This is my daily bread. without you.
Welcome to our time of prayer, and I just like to pray to our Father. So if you'll all bow with me. Our Father and our God, God of this entire universe, of our very planet, this earth, all of this was designed by you, and all of nature is under your control. Nothing escapes your notice. You are in the process of making things right and perfect again after this initial fall of man, and we've made selfish choices and all of nature suffers as a result. We acknowledge you as the grand weaver in the process of life and your desire to see mankind accept your great plan of saving us from this sin-sick world. As your followers, we would first want to acknowledge our sins to you and how we have fallen short in our obedience to you. Too often we relied on our own self-righteousness and self-serving behavior and ignored or minimized the needs of others in our own sphere. Forgive us, Lord, for both those sins that we have committed against others and those sins of omission where we knew to do right and didn't listen to your Holy Spirit, which resides in us, and we tuned you out. Forgive us as a local church, not exercising the many gifts and talents that you've given us to expand your kingdom. Forgive us for being satisfied and lethargic in the little we do and help to expand our souls by being disciplined in the Christian life, learning and intimately knowing you, more of you. Forgive us, Lord, for looking out for our own safety as an excuse to neglect or not to look out for the well-being of others. Help us to purify our motives. We thank you, Lord, for how through this crisis in the world we are seeing various acts of kindness being extended to others. We thank you for the sacrifice of many in the medical profession, the ambulance, the paramedics, and the medical administrators who are willing to put their own personal safety on the line in order to serve many, those many and the many more to come with the results of this plague that is come upon us. We petition you, Lord, asking for their safekeeping. We thank you, Lord, for the creativity and ingenuity you have and are giving to those scientists who are working for a neutralizing cure on this virus, for those engineers and technicians who are attempting to find simple and inexpensive means to quickly develop oxygen ventilators that are and will be greatly required in the near future. Please give us your grace and favor to these individuals. We thank you, Lord, through the shutdown and stay-at-home policies that you're giving us an opportunity to be more reflective and to draw even closer to you. Help us to develop a more intimate relationship with you through this ordeal. We thank you, Lord, that we are becoming more aware of how small our world really is and how we are all in need of not only a cure for this invisible disease, but more so for that invisible but eternally invisible deadly disease of sin. For unlike this virus, which may kill many, or those who may only be mildly affected or simple carriers, sin has infected all of humankind, and it is deadly for none of us to get out of this world alive physically. Help us, Lord, to use this opportunity to have creative ways to explain the nature and consequences of our sin of sin itself to our neighbors and friends and family. We thank you, Lord, for the many answers to prayer that you've already answered. We thank you for the remission of cancer and Frieda Wooten, and we pray for the continuing recovery to her immunity system within her body. We thank you for the return of Jim Crowfoot, Teresa Hoker, and Mary Dugan back home from various rehab centers. We thank you for the answered prayer for the safe return of Christina Archer's brother, John, from Mexico. Also for Tony Ford's sale of his house during these turbulent times. And many others answers to prayer that we praise you as the one who cares for us. You admonish us and give us that promise in 1 Peter 5:7 to cast our cares on you, for you care for us. With that, Lord, we pray for those needs, for the needs of our local church and those who are near and dear to our heart. We want to first pray for the Worsham family, who are dealing with their own family crisis, especially Val as a mother. We pray that as they spend those moments with their son Tim, they would be sweet and memorable. We pray for Tim that you would give him mental cognizance and the ability to speak clearly to his family, and that his pain would be managed to the point of tolerance. Uplift this family, O Lord, in their time of need. Give Pastor Steve clarity of mind also, as is his desire to continue to prepare and present your word to us in sermon form from Minnesota. Please alert him also as to when he needs to turn over those duties to us to allow him to rest and take comfort completely in you. Lift up our brother, Pastor Bob Sheridan of the Palos Bible Church, who has recently been diagnosed with COVID-19 and then now is in critical condition in ICU with pneumonia and is connected to a ventilator. Also, we lift up his wife, Adrian, as she deals with this concern. May she draw ever closer to you. We pray for the multitude of missionaries who are serving in the field and also who are subject to this global pandemic. Please keep them safe. We specifically lift up those missionaries, both active and retired, that you've entrusted us to support financially and in prayer. Please, Lord, keep them safe as well during this time, and encourage us to be diligent in our giving to continue to support them with their financial needs. We lift up Harold Cox and Barbara, his caregiver, who is wrestling with some possible internal bleeding. Give the doctors wisdom as how to properly diagnose his condition. We also pray for Madeline McMahon as she needs to get well enough in order to replace her heart monitor. Please bring healing to her. And prompt us, Lord, to pray for those others listed in our previous bulletins to be diligent to pray for their many needs. Please, Lord, give to Gary Archer and those who are assisting him wisdom and how to creatively and simplistically provide the best means possible to effectively present a church-type setting and worship service to all our congregation in order that we can maintain a continuity and community amongst us during the crisis. Help us, Lord, to remember to be generous in our giving to this and other ministries in order to continue the furtherance of your kingdom. We pray all these things in your name and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seeks the face of the God of Jacob.
Give Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. We bend our knees, O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things, O Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble.
Hello, Bethel Bible Church. This is Steve Worsham. You probably know that already. But I just wanted to give you a greeting from Stillwater, Minnesota. We're up here with our family and taking care of Tim. I wanted to thank the elders and the rest of the church for all your support and care. You're allowing us the freedom to come up here and be with Tim in his time of need. And we're very appreciative. Tim came home from the hospital on Wednesday and has had a couple of great days in the last 2 days. And so we're so glad to be up here. We know that there's a shutdown just about everywhere anyway. And so we're trying to do what we can from here. But just the fact that the elder board has given us the freedom to be by family has meant a great deal to us. So thank you. Thank you for your continued prayers for our family, and we are praying for you because we know that a lot of you are going through a great deal with the pandemic here and the lack of jobs at school and freedom in many different ways. And so we're praying for you and know that God knows what's happening, that He cares what's happening in our lives, and but if you have needs, please don't hesitate to call Dave Eber, Gary Archer, Rick, Peter, any of the leaders of the church and let them know. And I know they'll try and address those as best they can. And certainly we'll be praying for one another. Give one another a call. There are people who are going a little stir crazy, having had to be inside for all this time. And
maybe there's some shut-ins or people who don't get out very much who could use just some encouragement or even drop off some food or supplies. And so be in contact with one another and certainly be praying for one another. And let me do that for you right now, and then I'll give my message and we'll move on. Thanks. Lord, I pray that you'd be with my brothers and sisters back in Evergreen Park, Illinois, and beyond. I thank you for your love for each one of us. You are a great God. And despite the fact that we may be going through trials and difficulties, you are in control. You have not lost sight of what's happening in our lives and in our world. You have a purpose, and we don't always know what that is, but one of those purposes is certainly for us to draw closer to you and depend more on you, and to be encouraging to one another in the midst of this. And so be with Bethel, be with each of these individuals that watch this video, and bless them, Lord, and provide for them, and take away their anxiety, because in many cases, depending on jobs and bills and food and kids and all of that, Lord, people can become quite anxious. And so help them to lean into you, and Lord, be their strength at this time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is our third message from Luke chapter 22 and 23 on the trial of Jesus. And the title of my message is No Compromise. No Compromise. Jesus has been passed around over the last 10 or 12 hours. We're not sure exactly how long it is. But he's been passed around more than mosquito spray at a picnic. You know that people are looking for ways in which to put him to death, put him out of their lives, so that he no longer impinges on their power and their finances and their livelihood, and yet they're afraid to do it. And so each one has kind of passed him along to another, and he's been paraded before the Sanhedrin, before Annas the high priest and Caiaphas the high priest and Pilate, and now he's been tossed over to Herod. And that's where we pick up in Luke 23, beginning in verse 8. And so I'm going to read verses 8 and following, and then we'll pick up on our commentary there. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had long desired to see him, because he had heard about him, and was hoping to see some sign done by him. So he questioned him at some length, but he made no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by vehemently accusing him. And Herod with his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then, arraying him in splendid clothing, he sent him back to Pilate. And Herod and Pilate became friends with each other that very day, for before this they had been at enmity with each other. Herod looked at Jesus as a curiosity. I don't know that he thought of him as a threat. He was certainly aware of Jesus. There's no way any politician, governor, high priest, or anyone else would have been able to ignore what was going on with Jesus and his traveling circus and all of what was going on around Jerusalem and Israel. But he looked at him as a curiosity, sort of as a joker, a magician, or something like that at a party, who would entertain and thrill and give Herod some things to be entertained by. And would he be able to turn water into wine? That would be very beneficial at a party. Would he make the lame to walk or the blind to see? That would be something that would wow all his guests. You know, he could raise the dead. You know, that he had been known to do that. And so Herod was looking for Jesus to entertain him. And as far as we can tell from Scripture, that's all. And when Jesus didn't jump through those hoops as he had wanted him to, Herod became angry. Isaiah 53 foretold that Jesus would respond in just the way he did to Herod, and that was to be silent. And Isaiah 53 referred to him as a lamb before slaughter, and that he would remain silent. And that's how he stayed before Herod. And so Herod mocked him. He put royal clothing on him. In other words, making fun of him because the claim was that he was the king of the Jews. And then he finally sent him back to Pilate. And oddly enough, despite the fact that they had been adversaries before, now Herod and Pilate had become buddies. You know, misery loves company. People who are doing dastardly things often find solace with somebody else who thinks and does the same things, same kinds of things that they do. And so that's where Herod and Pilate are at this time. Pilate declared before the chief priests and the people now that after examining him, I did not find the guilt that you have charged him of, neither Herod or I. But the crowd now began to grow into a frenzy. And they said in front of Pilate, "Away with this man, release Barabbas to us." And for the third time, two times prior, now a third time, Pilate tries to punish him and release him, saying he had found no guilt in him, to be able to punish him with death. And the crowd grew urgent, Scripture tells us. The cries grew louder, and they demand that he be crucified. Barabbas was released. He was a thief. He was a rabble-rouser and quite possibly a murderer as well. And he was who they wanted freed. And Jesus was delivered over to their will, the book of Luke tells us. So it's interesting to note that the crucifixion of Jesus could not be traced to any one man. Annas passed him along. Caiaphas passed him along. Pilate sent him to Herod. Herod back to Pilate. And Pilate again said, "He's not guilty. And I'll punish him. I'll beat him. But I'm going to release him." And the people demanded that he be executed. John later states that he came unto his own, and his own received him not. It was the people who demanded his death. It was the same people who a week before or 5 days before were parading him through the streets of Jerusalem, throwing down palm leaves and cloaks and declaring him to be the king. And the fickle crowd 5 days later wants him to be crucified. Now, sometimes it's a vocal few that stir up a crowd, but it doesn't seem like it was only a few. It seems like there was a mass of humanity that wanted Jesus executed. And it appears that the crowd actually overruled the leaders. They couldn't be persuaded. And so there was a frenzy. There was a frantic nature to this crowd that they wanted Jesus crucified. Pilate and Herod's solution to punish him did not satisfy them. The first thing I want to suggest as a result of looking at what's happened here in this passage is that Roman numeral number one, majority rule, can make one look like a fool. We grow up in the United States of America and are taught that because of our form of government, the world changed, that the experiment with democracy, with representation by the people in order to make decisions was a unique one in civilization. There were roots of it in other civilizations such as Greece in the past, but nothing quite like the experiment of the United States, so that we're quite proud of that in our nation's history and in our studies in history. I think it has grown in such a way so that it seems of biblical proportions in regards to that this is the way that government ought to be. But the fact that majority makes decisions and that those decisions stand does not necessarily mean that those decisions are biblical and right in regards to God's word. When the children of Israel were wandering through the wilderness and God chose to bring Moses to the mountaintop to receive the law, and Moses was up there longer than they thought he ought to be, what was the people's response? Well, after a while, they figured Moses had abandoned them, and they began to gather up precious metals and jewels and gold, and built a golden calf and began to worship the calf and the pagan gods that it represented. And that was a majority rule. That was the nature of what the people wanted, and yet that was not at all what God wanted. And yet that was majority rule. That was what the people wanted. Later, when they arrived in the Promised Land, after they had wandered for a number of years, 12 spies were sent into the land to check it out. 10 reported that there were giants in the land and it was too dangerous and they shouldn't go in. Only 2 reported that the land was filled with milk and honey, that God had promised it to them anyway, God would provide. But because of the whining and complaining, that group of people were not allowed to go into the land. Only Joshua and Caleb and their tribes, and then the generations to come from the other 10 tribes. But those who complained, those who voted against going into the land and kept a majority of people out of it, perished before the children of Israel were able to go into the land. We find that in Numbers 13 and 14. So in this passage we see a group of religious leaders that and politicians that desperately were seeking for someone else to drop the hammer on Jesus. And they couldn't do it. They kept passing the buck, as we talked about last week. Annas, Caiaphas, Pilate, Herod, all would love to have had the other guy be the blame person to take the blame and crucify Jesus, and none of them would. Instead, it ended up being the people, the majority, who, for whatever reason, decided that Jesus should perish, that another thief should be released out of prison, Barabbas, and that Jesus should be executed. There are a number of reasons why majority rule does not necessarily mean biblical rule. First and foremost is that all of us are sinners. And although many times people put their best foot forward, that's not always enough. And so our decisions can be tainted by sin. And, you know, as a parent, have you ever made a decision that affected your children that probably was a selfish one? It wasn't in the best interest of your children. It wasn't necessarily in the best interest of your family. You just wanted it that way. And so you made the decision and made it stand, and maybe later on decided or felt like that wasn't necessarily the best thing I should have done. But sin affects our decisions. And if it can affect one, it can affect a number of people and even a majority. But all of us are sinners. Secondly, we're all affected by the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It doesn't matter which party, which group is heading up a particular government. Somebody's always pointing the finger at somebody else and saying, you're in it for the money, you're in it for the power, you're in it for whatever, you fill in the blank. But there's accusations left and right as to why people decide to do what they do in power, in government. And so, regardless, just because the greatest number of people decide that this ought to be the way a decision goes, doesn't mean it's biblical at all. And there's examples that we know of in our own nation. I'm of the belief that the abortion is sin. And a majority of people in a democratic society have decided that it's okay. Now, you can argue if that's true or not, but that's the way it is. And in 40 plus years, it hasn't been overturned by a vote. And so it appears that a majority still clings to that belief. And so all are affected by those things, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And far too often we're affected by the things that will benefit us rather than what is right. And then lastly, our view of the world is limited because we're limited. We think we know what's best for us, for our family, and even for our country, but we don't have God's eyesight. We don't have His view of the world. And so only God knows the end from the beginning. And so our ability to make good choices is limited. It doesn't mean that all governments are wrong, because there are some that trust God, follow His guidelines, follow His commandments and laws, and make good choices on down the line, even if they're not all God believers. There are still people who follow those rules because God's rules are good and beneficial to the people. Churches differ as to what form of government they have, and some are run by the denomination. The denomination hires and fires and moves people around and makes the decisions on property and things like that. Not necessarily the intricacies within the church, but denominations rule them. Or there's a congregational rule or elder rule. And in some cases, there's even some pastors that just take the bull by the horns and do sort of a monarchy kind of approach. But all of those have their benefits, and some of them work very well, depending on if the people are trusting and following Christ and God's Word. If they are, I'm not sure that any of them are necessarily right or wrong, but if God's in control and people are following after God and His Word, things will work in a church. On the other hand, I don't think even if the pastor is ruling, or the elders, or the congregation, or the denomination itself, if they're not following after God's Word and trusting Him, those kinds of government will fail as well, even within the church. And so all are legitimate, ineffective, but are susceptible to what? The fact that we're sinners. And that's true of majority rule. Jesus's accusers may have had any number of motives: fear, disbelief, the fear that if Jesus stirred the apple cart and caused things to change around there, that would affect their lives. And so whatever it was, they made the decision that he should perish. And innocence be damned, so to speak, in regards to the fact that Pilate and Herod both found that he was innocent. Roman numeral number 2, self-deception can empower an unbeliever. Whether it was Annas or Caiaphas, Herod or Pilate, they thought, I think, that they were more important and more knowledgeable than anyone else. And that's a dangerous place to be, but they had a haughty attitude. They thought, despite the fact that they couldn't pull the trigger, that they knew that Jesus was, certainly in Annas and Caiaphas's position, they believed that he was either a threat to their power or blasphemer or both, but they wanted him gone. And Herod and Pilate felt like they knew more than the religious leaders, and that they weren't going to be the ones to pull the trigger to execute Jesus. They wanted somebody else to do that. And so, but all of them, it seems as though, felt some sort of a threat, because look at how Jesus was led around. It says in some places it implicates the fact, or implies the fact, that Jesus was guarded by from anywhere from dozens to hundreds of soldiers. One man. Now, there could have been the idea that there was a threat that the people would turn. If in a week they could, in 5 days they could turn from believing Jesus is the King of Israel to wanting him crucified, what would keep them from turning again. And so it's somewhat understandable why they would have a large contingent of soldiers around. But they dragged him through the night. The proceedings were illegal because, first of all, they weren't to have trials at night. Secondly, in a number of these instances, Jesus' accusers had not yet made their accusations, and yet either the high priests or the governors were inquiring of things themselves. That was not orderly or proper. That's why Jesus stayed silent in the case of Herod, because Herod wasn't allowed to interrogate him until accusations had been made, and they hadn't been made yet in front of Herod. And so the proceedings were illegal for the most part, and these guys just felt empowered of their own volition. They were going to do things their way and not necessarily the proper way. And I get a mental picture of the white witch in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, when the character depicting Jesus, Aslan the Lion, gave his life, gave himself up to protect Edmund, one of the children that came into Narnia, and had fallen under the spell of the White Witch, and she was holding him captive and was going to put him to death, and Aslan gave himself up for Edmund. And so he was brought in the middle of the night before the White Witch and was bound with ropes, was thrown down, his mane was shaved off of him, and he was dragged up to this big flat rock, and they danced around him and mocked him, and then the White Witch raises a dagger and sort of gives a profession of faith of in herself and in her power and in her victory, and then plunges the knife, and Aslan's put to death. And she's deceived. She thinks she has won. And I'm certain that Satan, all through this process, from the betrayal in the garden to Judas's kiss, to each of these trials, to Peter's denial, all the way through, Satan was dancing. Satan was celebrating. Satan was patting himself on the back. And all of these people, I think, along the way felt the same way, that they were deceived. Whether it was self-deceived or Satan helped in that process, whatever it might have been. But I think that emboldened them. And that's a dangerous place to be. Self-deception is not uncommon in our society today. There are a lot of people who think they know better than God, better than Scripture, better than evidence around us in the universe that point to God, that says that we're without excuse to know that He's there. They know better. And that's a dangerous place to be. A self-deceived person believes that, in some cases, they're not bad enough to need a Savior. Maybe there is a God. Maybe there is a Jesus. Maybe He even died for our sins. But I don't need Him. I haven't committed the biggies. I haven't done the things that ought to send a person to hell. God is a loving God. God wouldn't send a person like me to hell. Except that Romans tells us differently. Romans 3:10 says, there's none righteous, not one. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the wages, or what we deserve for sin, Romans 6:23 says, is death, being separated from God forever. Jesus told the very religious and knowledgeable Nicodemus, one of the priesthood, Jewish priesthood, in John chapter 3, that he must be born again, even though he was devout, even though he was religious. Jesus told him, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. that's pretty plain. So you might believe that you're okay. You might believe that you're good enough. Scripture tells us, don't be deceived. All of us are sinners. All need a Savior. Some may understand that you need a Savior, but because of how good they think they are, they're pretty convinced that God is fortunate to have us on His side. And I know a lot of people that have sort of that attitude, that they're so good that God's lucky to have me. And wow, you know, I've been saved for 57 years. I was saved at the age of 6. And the longer I live, the more I feel like, sort of like Paul describes himself, oh wretched man that I am. I become more aware of my sinful desires, my sin nature, and my thoughts and my actions. And you know, that doesn't mean I haven't grown. That doesn't mean I haven't even still not plateaued or even that I'm still going in the right direction as far as my growth is concerned. But I'm painfully aware of how much I still have to go. And Romans 7 says this in verse 14, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do. And what I hate to do, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. And later on, Paul says in Romans 7:24, oh, wretched man that I am. And boy, you know, that's true. There's just times where I see, wow, it is amazing that God loves me and that God would save me. In the end, there are some people who also have this attitude of deception. It doesn't matter. Nothing matters. Ashes to ashes, dust to us, dust to dust. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. That's the attitude a lot of people have. It's a deception. And it's a deep deception because Scripture says that without trusting Christ, that we're doomed to an eternity without Him and an eternity of punishment. There's no other way to describe what hell is but punishment. So to believe that is to believe Satan's lies. And that's a terrible place to be. Despite how firm the opposition to Jesus was, or how dedicated they were to seeing His demise, they were not the reason Jesus ended up on the cross. Jesus chose to go to the cross, not just to fulfill Scripture, not just to do His Father's will. Those were certainly part of the equation, but it was out of love. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:14-15, for Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died for them and raised and was raised again. Christ's love compels us. It's His love that held Him on the cross, not the nails, not the will of man, but His own will, because He loved us. Paul says in Galatians 2:20 and following, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself up for me. So it wasn't Pilate. It wasn't Herod. It wasn't the Sanhedrin. It wasn't the Pharisees. It wasn't the mob that put Him on the cross. It was His love. Lastly, compromise can lead to your demise. That's the approach that Pilate tried to take. He tried to make everybody happy. he tried to suggest that, okay, maybe he's a bad guy. Maybe he's disrupted your society, but he's not guilty of death. And so here's what I'll do. I'll punish him. I'll beat him. And I'll give him a stern warning. And he'll leave me alone. And I'll send him on his way. That'll be enough. And so he tried to compromise. He wanted to please the Jews. And he wanted to give them a way to feel as though they've gotten their way. But he didn't want to be the one to put him to death. And was fearful of the backlash that that might bring. So he looked for a way to compromise. Compromise can be a valuable tool in human relations, in differences of opinion. People can find middle ground on which to thrive and to survive. It's an important skill to have. In marriage counseling, when I've had times where I've had to come in with a couple or families, one of the things that we try and teach is that people need to find ways in which to live together, and to live together requires compromise. Nobody can have their way all of the time, or it will destroy the family unit or destroy any kinds of relationships. And so it takes give and take. And so compromise is not in and of itself a bad thing. In fact, it can be a very important thing. But when we compromise spiritual truth, that's when it leads to disaster. Having worked with students over the years, one of the pitfalls that I warn them of is the danger of dating people who are not of like faith. And, you know, they talked about being a witness and trying to win people to Christ through their dating situations. And rarely do I feel as though that's the legitimate reason why they want to date that person. It's just that they're attracted to them or in love with them or in lust with them, whatever it might be. But rarely is there real drive to win them to Christ and then develop a relationship. It's the other way around. And the danger of that is more often than not that the person who is the Christian in those situations who's given in to this impulse is often the one who compromises their beliefs. They're the ones that either go to church by themselves or don't go at all anymore. They're the ones that allow the other spouse to make the decisions in regards to what the children do on a Sunday or what the children do in regards to children's programs, youth programs, those sorts of things. And more often than not always, but more often than not, it's the Christian who compromises, who gives in. And so it's a dangerous place to be, to compromise your spiritual values and truths and beliefs. And most certainly that is in regards to our relationship with Jesus Christ. People try and compromise in their beliefs and how they live in this world. Having grown up in the church and known what it was to be like raised in a Christian home, I always had that desire to see what the other half of the world lives like. And there was things that were enticing to me and that my friends were involved in. Friends were encouraging me to join them in. And at times you wanted to compromise. You wanted to retain the things that you believed in and also experience the things that the world offered. And it was a dangerous tug of war as a young person. And I didn't always win that tug of war. I didn't listen to God all the time. And so, as believers, we can't compromise our spiritual values. Jesus said it this way, he who is not for me is against me, in Matthew chapter 12, verse 30. He who does not gather scatters. So there's not a middle ground. You can't have Jesus and the world ruling your life. In fact, he said at one point to his followers in Luke chapter 14, and we talked about this in the past. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yea, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Now, Jesus isn't asking us to separate from our families, but he is requiring of us a devotion to him above all others. And if it came to deciding which one we're going to be loyal to, his requirement is that we trust in him most. Now, most of the time he's not going to ask us to do that. You know, there's not too many of us who, like Abraham, have been asked to sacrifice our own child. But there are times in which we have to make decisions. I want to be liked by my child, or am I going to try and raise them the way God wants me to raise them? Now, that's a rub, because we like to be our kids' friends. But being the parent doesn't always allow us to be the child's friend at each and every moment. There are times in which we've got to make the tough decisions in training up our children the way they should go. And God wants us to decide on him as the ones we are devoted to. And certainly in that regard, as to our eternal life, our spiritual life, who am I going to be devoted to? Who am I going to trust with my eternal life? Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. One will inevitably supersede the other. You can't mix your faiths. You can't mix your devotion. He knows that if we allow others to work their way into the place, the God place in our lives, we won't have room for him. And so we can't compromise like Pilate compromised to try to make everybody happy. We can't compromise our faith and our trust in our eternity. We need to trust Jesus Christ, because he said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So we've looked at the fact that there are multiple ways of rejecting the truth of Jesus. Go with the crowd. The crowd knows I'm trusting the crowd. Or be persuaded by self-deception. I'm smarter. I don't need a savior. I'm good enough. Or lastly, compromise. All roads lead to God. As long as I am committed, as long as I believe in something strongly, I'm going to end up in the right place. That's not what Jesus said. If he says no man comes to the Father but by me, it can't be through another avenue. It can't be through just good works. It can't be through Buddha. It can't be through Muhammad. It can't be through any other avenue. It's Jesus Christ. And that's why he went to the cross. That's why he allowed what took place to take place. As he said, he could have called a legion of angels and stopped all of this. But he chose to go to the cross for you and for me. And so be aware of the avenues of deception that are out there, and do not compromise when it comes to Jesus Christ. If you've never placed your faith and trust in him, today's the day of salvation. Today is the day to give control of your life over to him. Romans 10:9 says, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead, you can be saved today. You don't have to go through a pastor like me or anybody else. You don't have to go to a certain church, though. Once you come to Christ, that's certainly a place to plug in and grow and be encouraged and encourage others. But if you believe these things to be true for you, that Jesus came to this earth for a purpose, and that was to die in your place, to take away the power of sin in your life, to have a substitutionary death on your behalf, so that you wouldn't have to pay for your own sin, and that he rose again from the grave with 500 witnesses, Corinthians tells us, of the living Jesus in body here on earth. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15 that it proves he has the power over sin and death, that he can forgive sin and he can grant eternal life. And if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead, Romans 10:9 says, you will be saved. Your sins are forgiven. It's already been paid for. And we just need to trust that that's true for us. And so if you've never prayed and asked Christ into your life, I'd encourage you to do that today. If you have already, live a life of no compromise. Trust Christ each day. Follow him explicitly. Don't give in to the crowd. Don't give in to self-deception. Don't give in to compromise. Live with a faith in Jesus Christ and follow him closely. Let's pray. Lord, I pray for each one of these folks. I pray that you would strengthen them in their walk with you. Help them not to give in to the world and the world's view and the peer pressure that can mount. I pray that you would help them not to be deceived by their own reasoning and their own ability to perceive things in a certain way, but to trust your word as the truth. And then, Lord, help them not to compromise. Help them not to try and come up a way with to try and please you and the world and their own desires all at the same time. Help them to trust you explicitly and follow after you closely. And we'll give you the praise and the glory for that. And Lord, if there's one here who's not trusted you, I pray that they would just ask you to come into their life, forgive them of sin, and I pray that they would thank you for what you've already done for them on the cross, and that you would come into their heart and life and change them and cause them to be more like you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This is amazing grace. This is
We'd like to thank you for all attending our second week of the virtual worship service in the COVID-19 stay-in-place isolation. Remember to keep praying for those people that are ill and various needs that are mentioned and that were written in your prior bulletins. During this time of the slowdown, thank Him for the crisis. That this has caused the whole world to take a deep reflection of the power and the nature of our Lord, who is ultimately is in control. Pray that many souls would come to Christ as a result of this crisis. Pray that the Lord would give us boldness to speak His name to a skeptical but seeking world. And remember to especially pray for those on the front line of the crisis in the medical field and the paramedics and the ambulances, many of whom are putting themselves at risk for contracting the disease. Pray for their well-being and safety. Pray for those that are in their governing authority over us, from the president on down to our local leaders. There are many tough decisions ahead that impact us all, both financially and medically. We also pray that you pray for Gary Archer and the rest of us who are asking God to give us creative and simplistic means to bring you all some continuity and community at Bethel Bible. We have various media formats that we've tried, and we believe that we can fine-tune this so that we can have some live interaction in the future. This will mean that you also will have to be flexible yourselves and be willing to try different technologies. We realize that this can be confusing to some, and who feel very techno-challenged, but bear with us. We may very well go kicking and screaming into the 21st century. Once we find a format that works well, we may very well be able to connect to our shut-ins and those of us who may be ill, are too ill to come to the worship Sunday. So we're working on this. Finally, remember you're part of a local body of believers as well as the Church Universal. As a local body, we still need your tithes and offerings. We need to maintain the salaries of Pastor Steve, Tim Kitchen, Gary Archer, as well as the continuing monthly bills of the church. We've reduced the heating and minimized the electrical usage as well, but we still have other costs. So as you are so led by the Lord, please mail in your offering to the church at 3215 West 96th Street in Evergreen Park, 60805. And I'm going to repeat that again. So that is Bethel Bible Church at 3215 West 96th Street, Evergreen Park, 60805. Remember to check regularly back at the Bethel Prayer and Information page for different updates that are maybe coming up or different ways that we can communicate. Thank you for your patience. Thank you again for attending the service with us today, and may the Lord richly bless you.